لا يتدبرون القرآن.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Welcome back. Before answering the questions that we received through the emails, I would like to remind you, inshallah ta'ala, next time we'll start with the explanation of the Quran. We'll start with أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم and then بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. And even if we take some time, but this is something that we say all the time. We say it all the time, every time we recite the Quran, so we need to get to understand what it means, what's the effect of that in our hearts, and how can we live accordingly, and how that should affect our lives actually, because every verse we learn should have an effect in our lives and should get us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because this is the miraculous words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brother Abu Malik from Nigeria, he sent a question asking about the whispers that a person would get in his heart. Are we asked or questioned in the Day of Judgment? Will we be responsible for the whims and the whispers that a person would get? Or are we responsible only for the physical actions that we do? To answer this question, because we mentioned a few episodes before about the last verses of Surah Al-Baqarah, and we mentioned a hadith in it of how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested the companions radiallahu anhum with the third verse before last in Surah Al-Baqarah. And you can refer back to it. And again, this is something good that we all do, that go back to the Qur'an, open the Qur'an, read it, see the translation. And this is another question, what's the best translation for us to use when it comes to understanding the Qur'an? Read the verse in Arabic so that you don't deprive yourself from the rewards by reciting every letter in the Qur'an is equal to 10 rewards, as the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha. And he said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, لا أقول ألف لام ميم حرف ولكن ألف حرف ولام حرف وميم حرف. That ألف لام ميم, just by saying ألف لام ميم, which is the first verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, for example, this is not one letter. ألف is one letter, لام is one letter, ميم is one letter. That means by reciting this, that doesn't take much time, a person would get 30 rewards. One حسنة, one reward, is better than this whole world and whatever it contains. This life that we live in, time is so precious. How can we utilize the time so that we do not regret it in the Day of Judgment? How much time that we waste and how much injustice that we commit to ourselves. We'll give you an example. If you have a child, for example, that finds a piece of a diamond, a big piece of diamond, for example, and he doesn't see the value of it, and it seems to him like a piece of glass. So he walks in the street with this piece of glass, and a jeweler would ask him, let me see this. And he would tell him, can I give you $100 for it? And you give it to me. The child will be very happy with it, with the $100. But if he realized the value of what he's carrying with him, he won't be satisfied with the $100. Imagine how much valuable things we have in our life. The most valuable thing in our life is the deen of Allah, the deen of Al-Islam. The most valuable thing in our life is the book of Allah, the Quran. So that every letter we recite is equal to 10 rewards. One reward is better than this whole world and whatever it contains. Life is too short. And that's why we need to utilize every second of it in what pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How can we do that? It doesn't mean that a person would isolate himself or herself to recite Quran all day and all night. This is not the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. But how can we get to know the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam? We need to learn the Quran, and we need to have the patience to learn the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, so that we utilize our times in the best way and the way that pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So once you open and you recite the verse, then read the explanation of it. So the third verse before last in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in it, وَإِن تُبْدُوا مَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَوْ تُخْفُوا يُحَاسِبُكُمْ بِهِ اللَّهِ فيغفر لمن يشاء ويعذب من يشاء والله على كل شيء قدير. That لله ما في السماوات ما في الأرض. Of course it starts with that, that to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala belongs all that is in the heavens and all that is in the earth. And if you show something or you conceal it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows about it, and you will be held accountable for it. So this verse, when it was revealed, as we mentioned before, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they fell into their knees and they said, O Prophet of Allah, we have been ordered to make salah. and to pay zakah and to perform jihad fighting in the cause of Allah, and all of that you are capable of doing. But this verse we're not able to fulfill it in the most perfect way. Because it means that your whims, your whispers, you will be held accountable with whatever thoughts that comes into your mind. The Prophet ﷺ told them, would you like to be like the nations before when they said we listen and we disobey? Say, سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. Say, we listen and we obey. وَفْرَانَكَ رَبَّنَا وَإِلَيْكَ الْمَصِيرِ. The narrator of the hadith, when he said, فَلَمَّا ذَلَّتْ أَلْسِنَتُهُمْ, when their tongues humbled itself with سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. They submitted themselves to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered them, because they realized that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful, the most wise. As a result of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the last two verses of Surah Al-Baqarah. Go and read it and see what the benefit from it. You would see that in it Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that He would not have a burden on the human beings, something that they cannot bear, and one of which our thoughts. So that means we are not questioned by the thoughts that comes into our minds as long as it's not translated into actions. And this is also the Prophet ﷺ said in the authentic hadith, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala relieved this ummah from what a person would speak to himself about. The thoughts that comes into our minds. We know that the shaitan whispers, and a person can get thoughts into his own mind. This is not something that we will be held accountable with regarding to this, as long as it's nothing but thoughts. Once a person make a decision, once a person have the strong intention to commit something, if it's a sin, then the person needs to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Once a person do something physically, then if it's something that is a sin, a person needs to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the beautiful hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that says, if a person have the intentions that he would do a good deed and he doesn't do it, he would get a reward. And if a person have the intentions to do a good deed and he does it, he will get 10 other rewards. And if a person have the intentions to do a bad deed and he doesn't do it, then he will get one reward. And this is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why a Muslim should constantly intend to do what is good. So in the hadith and in the verses as we heard, we won't be questioned when it comes to our thoughts. Only things that are done physically, things that we say with our tongues, we have to consider that what we say is actions. Some of us, we do not realize that words are actions. We think that actions is when you hit someone, when you move, when you walk, but also what we speak. A word can take the person outside the fold of Islam. If he says the word of disbelief, or curses Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or whatever, and there is sins that done by one's tongue, how much pain that a person can afflict to others as a result of not paying attention to what we say. So actions done physically, things that are being said, all of these things a person will be held accountable, and he has to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if he commits a sin. But only thoughts, we need to push it away. Otherwise, if we don't push away the evil thoughts, what happens? That can be easily translated into actions, and then the person will be held accountable with regarding to these thoughts. So once the whispers comes, a person should not take that and then act according to it and make it, give it more thoughts and make decisions. No, we should push it away if it's something that is evil, something that displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the shaitan. And this is even something that the companions radiallahu anhum went to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and they told him, that sometimes they get some thoughts, they're not able to even say it. They would hate it so much because it's something that of disbelief, for example, comes into their minds. The Prophet ﷺ, when he heard that, he said, you find this in yourself, ذَكَ صَرِيحُ الْإِيمَانِ. This is Iman, this is the clear faith. Why is that? Because shaitan is throwing some whispers into your mind and you hate it, that means this is not your belief. The human being, they have this tendency that if they believe in something, they're proud of it. But if you feel that you hate it so much, makes you so much uncomfortable, give you so much pain, when a thought of disbelief or something passes into your mind, then know for sure that this is not you. This is the shaitan had through such a whisper in you. What to do? Just push it away. Don't think about it. Recite the Quran. Make istighfar. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for help. And this is what we should do with the thoughts and the whispers and so on. But a person is not to be held accountable with only thoughts. But if it translates to actions, then this is where the responsibility is. The second question was about the best translation to the verses of the Quran. Again, as we heard before, the Quran is the language of the Quran, the Arabic that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose. So again, when we recite قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ, this is Quran. But if we translate the meaning of it, this is not Quran. This is the explanation of the meaning of the Quran. Why do we need to translate the Quran? We need to translate the Quran. We need to speak like this so that we get to know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. But this is not the Quran. This is the explanation of the Quran. To get the rewards, you have to recite the Quran, the exact same words that was revealed to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So yes, we need the translation. But again, a sincere advice. Don't be just satisfied with the translation. Take it as a mean and start learning the beautiful language of the Quran so that we can comprehend the Quran and we get closer to the Quran by relating to the Quran. Makes you love the Quran. Makes you love the companions radiallahu anhum and the Prophet even more. So this is not a particular language to a certain group of people. This is the language that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for the final revelation. And again, don't forget your children. Make them study the Arabic language and make them comprehend the Quran when they're young in age so that they will become a real bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unto you. So we need, yes, the translations of the Quran. When it comes to the English language, there are more than one translation, but one of the good translations, the one that is famous as Sahih International, for example, or the one by Dr. Muhsin Khan. These are good translations of the Quran because it translates the meanings. It translates the meanings, and there's so much effort in these translations to bring the most or the closest meanings of the verses of the Quran. So use these types of translations and do the best you can so that you would understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. And again, by getting to know that from someone that mastered the Arabic language makes a big difference. And that's why this is a mandatory thing for anybody that studies the knowledge and wants to be a scholar in the religion of Islam. We have to master the language of the Quran so that we'll be able to relate that to others in whatever language there is. But we also need to encourage people to learn the Quran and to learn the language of the Quran, the Arabic language of the Quran. Also, another point which is very important for us when it comes to the language of the Quran, and I've seen this in many places where people tend to belittle the importance of the Arabic language, and they think this is an issue of culture or something of that nature. We need to change that opinion. We need to change this idea. And again, the reason for that is to be able to live the Quran, to be affected by the miracle. Imagine, again, at the time of a messenger of Allah, you saw a miracle with your own eyes. How strong that is would make you firm and steadfast. Definitely, it would make a big difference. The same thing with the Quran. This is the miracle that was sent to the Prophet ﷺ for people to listen to it. And this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran. When the jinn was sent and they heard the Prophet ﷺ, they said, قَالُوا إِنَّ سَمِعْنَا قُرْآنًا عَجَبًا, that we heard an amazing, a unique Quran. We heard. And we still can hear it. We still can listen to the Quran. The Prophet ﷺ did not write the Quran when it was revealed to him. He recited it, alayhi salatu wasalam. Did not edit it, the Quran. Did not say, wait, you know, keep this on the side till I review it and then we can edit it. This didn't happen. Once the Prophet ﷺ spoke it and the companions radiallahu anhum wrote it and they memorized it, this is the same Quran that we recite today, 1400 years after the Prophet ﷺ. It's the same Quran with its miraculous nature as we heard. So, learning the Arabic language, it's something that would make the person comprehend this miracle. As if you are living at the times of the messengers, and you're seeing the miracle with your own eyes, but instead you would recite it, you would hear it with your own ears. Some people say if we were living at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, the matter would have been easier for us. This is not a valid excuse. Actually, a person one time, he said that in front of Hudhaifa, one of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, one of the early generation of Islam, said that to him. And he said that this is not valid for such a person to say that. Why? Because the companions radiallahu anhum, they went through severe tests. And we do not know if we were be to be steadfast that these tests are not. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose them. We have to witness the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this is the time where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for us to live. So we have to be pleased with the qadr, with the destiny of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to witness the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And at the same time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. So as a result of that, we can witness with our own selves the miracle of the Quran. And this is something that definitely it would make a big difference if a person would learn the language of the Quran and to spend the time. It's worth it to spend years to learn the language of the Quran and to inculcate that in our children so that they hold fast to the Quran, so that the language that we communicate with one another will be the language of the Quran by the will of Allah. When people go for Hajj, they see sometimes even most of the people they would speak English or French or whatever there is to one another, Muslims. But why can't we learn the language of the Quran from early ages so that our form of communication that would help for us to be one ummah and for the joy of this life to comprehend the Quran, to see the miracle in a daily basis when we recite the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what is of course more important than what is mandatory is to act according to the Quran. And this is inshallah by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can get that by understanding what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from you in any language. And this is our job in this program, to get to know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us, so that we have no excuse, so that we can enjoy the Quran, and so that we can submit ourselves to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah, next time we'll start with the Quran and to explain the verses from the Quran. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who benefit and recite the Quran and gain the rewards from the most merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala. So till next time, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our sins. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا.
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا.
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا.